I've lived in the Calder Valley in the Yorkshire Pennines for 20 years now. Enough to know what locals know, which is that we have some challenging weather at times in these parts. I've always been fascinated by how weather gets right inside our lives, shaping what we do and feel, who we see, what we wear, what we eat, and just about everything. I've come to think of weather as part of the weave of life, and to think of the way we experience weather and seasons with all our senses, our emotions, and our imaginations as living the weather. So, early in 2015, I began a study to discover how people in the valley actually go about living the weather. Local participants helped me by sending regular reports and stories and pictures about how weather was influencing their lives and talking to me over the changing seasons. The Calder Valley of my study includes a wide sweep of countryside and small towns, as well as many small rural dwellings, high ground and moors, and valley bottoms. Some of the participants to the study live high on the moors, others in the valley towns or in small hillside hamlets. It was an eventful year for them to document, with some tropical-style early summer storms, then a summer of cool and wet weather, a spectacular autumn, and a wet and stormy winter culminating in the devastating Boxing Day floods. At the end of the summer, we embarked on making a documentary film with some of my participants to get to know their experiences of living the weather.
For me, walking has always been an essential part of the writing process. It's partly to do with the blood moving around the body, sending fresh oxygen to the brain. It's also the movement, not so strenuous that the effort forces itself into your consciousness, but repetitive, step after step after step. It helps to induce a certain state. Meditative, perhaps, receptive to creativity. I might have a plot problem in a story, some knotty issue which I can't resolve, or a character who isn't behaving the way I want them to. I don't go out and purposefully think about it, I just walk. Often as not, by the time I get home, the problem will have resolved itself. On these occasions, my thoughts tend to be very inward, the walk purely a vehicle for the creative process, and it's best if the surroundings are unobtrusive, not too eye-catching, not worrying or disturbing in any way. And it's best if the weather is unobtrusive too, no storms, no blizzards, no heat waves. Some days I've arrived home ready to put ideas on paper straight away, but with no memory of where I've walked. There's another way of walking. When I go out with all my senses alert, absorbing everything around me and letting it become part of the creation. When I want to notice every detail, as the details will become part of what I write. But mostly, walking is neither of these. It's just walking. When you've been sitting at a computer for hours, it's great to just be able to get out and stretch your legs and breathe in the fresh air. And having a dog makes me get out and do that, whatever the weather.
25th of October 2015. I'm observing that an important part of weather is how it touches us physically. Sticky heat on skin, or rain in face, or frozen fingers, or the deafening noise of a storm, or that indefinable but instantly recognisable scent of the arrival of autumn. The different weathers we get in this valley engage people's senses quite powerfully, yet people can sometimes struggle for words to convey what this feels like. I've come to think that is partly because these physical sensations aren't singular feelings. Scents, for example, are always experienced as sounds and sights and sensations of touch. We can squelch and kick our way through the muddy smells and colours of a wet autumn, our fingers and ears tingling in the damp chill, our noses running in the strong cold wind as it whistles and rustles in the leaves, and our trousers wet and heavy against our legs in the rain. When people have tried to explain these kinds of multisensory feelings to me, they're also describing their emotional responses and sometimes their orientations to different weather conditions and seasons too. Some have told me that they think it's good for the moral fibre or the soul to get out in all weathers and to let rain penetrate their clothing. Others have talked to me of being keen to experience the feel of rain, but from inside a good waterproof jacket and boots so they stay dry. Weathery sensations of all types are part of us and how we feel about ourselves and others, and about the trivialities of life as well as its major events.
The rain in this valley can be so relentless, you know, day after day after day. Sometimes it just feels so miserable. It wears you down, because there's no way you can be outside and stay dry in that sort of persistent rain. So you end up not going out unless you absolutely have to. Just trudge into the train station to go to work, and your world just shrinks. So that's why running is so important to me. It's a way of still being outside despite the rain. You don't have to try and protect yourself. You know you're going to get soaked through straight away.
Sometimes, even before you start, my running shoes are usually left soaking wet and muddy because I never washed them after the last one. And I've just left them on the doorstep, so they're already cold and wet when I put them on. Doesn't matter though, because you soon warm up when you're running. It can be hard to make yourself go out though, even though you know that once you're outside, it'll be fine. It's leaving that's the problem. Looking out at the rain and wondering if it'll brighten up later. That's why running together is good, because one of us can always talk the other one into going out. We often go running with friends as well, and that really does make you go out, because it's already been arranged and your friends will be waiting for you.
I tend to head for the woods in the rain, not up on the tops where it's more exposed. And I think I actually enjoy that sort of claustrophobic, closed-in feeling of the rain and the trees. I think running can sort of put you in a bit of a trance place anyway, and the rain just adds to that. And then sometimes it can be really quite exciting when it's lashing it down and everybody would think you were totally mad for going outside. And there you are, sliding around through the mud and over the rocks, and the paths have all become mini streams, and you can't see a thing because of the rain on your glasses.
We're really lucky to have Hardcastle Crags as a wet weather backup. I think it must be one of the loveliest places there is to go running, and it's right on our doorstep. You can get right down by the river in places, skipping over the rocks and the stepping stones. And in other places, you can stretch your legs out through the pine woods.
And there's just something about running that's really freeing. It's escaping everything, work, the house, organising, planning, sorting, and just being a creature running through a wood. And if it's raining, it's raining.
Thanks, from two.
I don't know about hill ropes. I don't think that's my thing.
I don't know where you're at.
No.
First shower then.
Yeah.
November 12th, 2015. The more I drive up and down the hills of the Calder Valley, the more I realise it makes a great deal of difference whether you live and spend your time in the valley bottoms or on the tops. Sharp-sided Pennine Hills give onto wooded and more populous valleys below in a confluence of cascading waterways. The hills are sided and topped by farmers' fields and moors of heather and bracken, and are speckled with villages and hamlets of old stone cottages. I'm realising how the distinctive topography and social history combines with the Pennine weather to create conditions where the valley tops and bottoms experience different microclimates even on the same day. The valleys have the benefit of being somewhat sheltered from the blasting elements of wind and horizontal rain, and the hail and snow when it comes. And that makes life seem less blown sideways than on the tops. The valleys are more conducive to growing, and in any season, little pockets of sheltered sun can create an almost Mediterranean feel. The weather up on the moors is nearly always interesting, with spectacular skies and cloud formations, and a light that cannot be achieved in the valleys below. The snow can be beautiful, with a shifting snow line creating challenges for those living and working higher up. And then there are temperature inversions, and when that happens, all you can see from the tops is mile upon mile of wondrous misty seas washing the valleys and making islands out of the hills.
We've lived up on Todmorden Moor for a few months now, and on a good day, it's beautiful with views across the valley, north to the Bridestones, Studley Pike to the east, Inchfield Moor to the south. It's often raining, and the wind turbines on Flower Scar Hill will be hidden in mist. When we first visited the house, it was the first weekend in January, and as we drove up, sleet fell and wind blew around us. We left immediately after that first and only viewing and decided it was the house for us. We wonder to this day what it was on that horrible winter's day that sold us on living up here. We'd worried about what the weather in winter might bring and the effect this would have on our lives and our mood. Would it be a constant storm, cold, wet, windy and dark? Jonathan seemed more optimistic than I felt, and he was excited by the hope for a heavy snowfall. We both secretly wondered if we'd made a huge mistake buying a remote cottage on top of an exposed hill. However, as soon as we arrived to live here, we realised this wasn't the case and have gradually decided that while winter may not be pleasant, looking out on the fields, the hills and the animals is going to be many times better than looking out of the window on a winter's day in the city. When you have two energetic dogs who need long daily walks, you have no choice but to face the weather, whatever it is doing that day. You learn pretty quickly that it's easier just to try and ignore the bad weather and get on with it. And for doing so, you often experience days and times outdoors that you never would do otherwise. Getting up at 6 a.m. on a winter morning, I've often seen the most special, secret, beautiful parts of a day. And I have memories of a fresh frost, a giant orange setting moon, technicolour skies as the sun rises, just me and the dogs. On days when I'm tired, hungover, feeling ill or fed up, going outside and getting some fresh air seems to have a medicinal effect that I can't get elsewhere. Being outside in the city used to mean being confronted by concrete, cars, unhappy looking and often unfriendly people. houses, large roads, rubbish and mess. Now we step outside our front door and we're greeted by grass, trees, horses, swallows, goldfinches, bats, dry stone walls, an endless sky unobscured by buildings. And I can't imagine ever wanting to live in the city again.
Hello. Oh, morning.
26th of November 2015. One of the main ways in which many people experience weather is by travelling, on foot, on a bike, in cars, buses or trains. Some of these modes of transport appear to involve more direct engagement with weather than others. Who could doubt that you're engaging with weather when you're soaking wet on your bike or walking to work in a short-sleeved shirt on a fine summer's day? But driving in a car also involves engaging with the weather. People have described driving up and out of the valley into spectacular early morning sunrises. Sometimes they'll stop the car and get out to take a photo on their phone, or just to soak up the ambience of an amazing weather moment. Although it would be easy to assume that the car simply insulates you from the outside world, the experience of weather from inside the car is always a pretty direct one. Whether it takes the form of the noisy power of torrential rain, or the feel of high crosswinds on the motorway, or bright skies and long-range views, or the sun in your eyes as you scrabble for your sunglasses. Most of my participants have experienced the feeling of moving through different weather conditions on car journeys. This often feels strange and sometimes exciting, or sometimes it's depressing if the weather seems to be closing in on the journey home from work. In some ways, instead of insulating people from the weather, their cars are like personal pods, whizzing them through and enabling them to encounter the varied and changing climates of the region.
I drive a lot for work, and having gone from a very small car to a larger car, it's a lot more practical and a nicer drive. It's quite a spacious car, so it's great driving it at the moment because I've got a lot of room to fit things in. It's red inside and it looked cute. I chose it. When I'm driving, from once I leave the house to either go to work, I'm thinking about what I've got on during the day, what the weather conditions are going to be like, what the M62 is going to be like, whether I'll be in a traffic jam, and I'm planning what route I should take depending on what the weather's like. If it's raining, then I'll be listening to the radio and hear also the traffic news, and if they say there's delays, then I'll be thinking about doing an alternative route. If I've got passengers, I'll be talking, think about things that I've got to do during the day. I could be thinking personal things, I could be talking on the phone over, to friends, or I could be singing. If I do drive in the sunshine, which is very rare these days, I have the music on quite loud and sing louder than I probably do normally. If it's icy, then I drive more carefully. If it's raining, I drive more carefully because of the slippery conditions. So I probably do slow down more. I feel more careful when it's raining. On the way home from work, especially when it's night and the fog is quite bad, when you come off the M62, on a few occasions it's been quite dense, thick fog. It's quite scary actually, because you've got other drivers that want to go faster, but I won't. That scares me, the fog, because you can't see in front of you a lot of the time.
9th of December 2015. Driving and walking around the Calder Valley, I always see people out and about. Even on top of a remote moor on a cold, windy day, you'll bump into a group of walkers or a cyclist or a runner or two. For some people, getting outside and having a regular dose of fresh air is a bit of a religion. It's seen as therapeutic and grounding. It's good for the body and the mind, the spirit and the soul. Many of my participants enjoy outdoor activities like cycling and running, or walking and climbing. And some have a very deep commitment to the qualities of fresh air and the outdoors. But even people who don't see themselves as outdoorsy types tell me they feel cooped up and hemmed in if they're unable to get out. Calder Valley fresh air, in different seasons and weathers, including the wind and the rain, is a potent force to be reckoned with. It isn't the type of fresh air that just sits there. In sustained wet or wintry weather, some people tell me they go for good waterproof and windproof clothing to protect them from the elements, while others prefer to face and feel the weather more directly, even if that means living with damp jeans against their skin for several hours. Some of my participants have jobs working outdoors, and they feel lucky to have the opportunity to be connected with the environment and to engage deeply with the changing seasons, even though that sometimes means being bruised and battered by them too.
When I was a kid, we lived in a place called Crawshay Booth in Rosendale, and around my mum and dad's house there were a lot of woods, and we were allowed to just go out and play. So me and my friends would just disappear into the woods. I never really had an idea of a career that I wanted to do or anything like that until I was maybe 13 or 14, and we were sat in school and we were going round the class saying what we wanted to do as a job. Sat next to me was one of my best mates, Dan, and he said he wanted to be a forest ranger. And the minute that came out of his mouth, I just said, yeah, I want to be a forest ranger too. And I thought, this is how I can carry on playing out in the woods for the rest of my life. I'm a freelance woodland manager and forester. I love my job, and there's a few different things that I like about it. One of them's the freedom that it gives me. Nobody expects me to be anywhere at a specific time. The other thing that I like about my job is I feel like I'm doing something meaningful that I believe in. Lots of our woodlands in the UK are undermanaged, so it's nice to be part of the process of sorting out biodiversity. A lot of my time is actually spent at the laptop. I do forest management plans for other woodland owners, drawing maps on computers, measuring areas. So if I look on an aerial photo, I can see straight away where the ponds are, where the areas of open ground are, exactly where the line is, where it changes from conifer to broadleaf. When you look at an aerial photo, you can't really work out how many tons of timber per hectare are there. I couldn't tell you if it was ready for thinning or if you could get a machine in there easily, if it needs drainage. So you've got to go and stand in the wood and have a look at it and get a feel for it. When I'm working in a woodland, I'm looking at it as an ecosystem as a whole. And when I'm working, doing thinning in the woodland, that's why I'm there. I'm there to have an impact on the ecosystem. So I feel like just another animal going about its business within that ecosystem. I don't mind feeling the elements. I love working outside. I love getting filthy, getting cold. It makes me feel like I've done a day's work.
The weather year of my study has been an eventful one, which at times seemed to defy the seasons. Many participants found the unremittingly cool, grey and wet summer of 2015 to be hugely disappointing and felt a strong sense of injustice about it. Then the winter was weirdly warm, with almost constant rain, culminating in the worst floods in living memory on Boxing Day. But never a sustained cold and crisp period to make it feel like a proper winter. Some of my participants have described a growing unease about the wrongness of the seasons, and the sheer scale of the floods plays into an underlying anxiety about climate change and global warming. Some have told me that the floods meant that only now do they really get climate change, viscerally and personally, even though they've understood it cognitively and politically before. The sheer scale and devastation of the Boxing Day floods was totally shocking. At the same time, in the weeks and months after the floods, we have seen unleashed the most incredible sense of community spirit, with seemingly boundless mutual support, as well as the generosity of strangers, and a passionate loyalty to the town of Hebden Bridge and other local communities. But no one doubts that the floods change the atmospherics of the place, and of people's relationships with the weather, possibly for good. People have felt wounded by the weather, but with the hope and promise of spring, they have started to dare to notice and describe magical and redemptive weather moments once again. Moments that seem to pierce through everyday troubles and trivialities. Calder Valley weather can be challenging, but it can also create the purest and most brilliant moments of rejoicing.